Over 60 unarmed men have been killed by Dallas policemen since 2001, with only one indictment to date. The practice of the Dallas Police Department and the District Attorney's Office to give safe haven to policemen who kill will no longer be tolerated. We are releasing a report based on the Dallas Police Department's records that clearly shows that Blacks and Hispanic fatalities account for almost 75% of the fatal Dallas Police Department officer-involved shootings. That puts Dallas 17% higher than the national rate. Mothers Against Police Brutality, Dallas Communities Organizing for Change, and other community groups will formally file a federal complaint and request for a federal investigation of the Dallas Police Department with the Department of Justice in the coming weeks. We are announcing today that we will fight the new 72-hour shooting investigation policy that was quietly implemented by Chief Brown all the way to the Supreme Court. We challenge the City Council and Mayor Rawlings to revoke this new policy. This policy of giving officers that are involved in shooting 72 hours to view any visible video footage and to have access to internal affairs report before making an official statement is sinister, unconstitutional, and is unethical. It encourages untruthful officers to lie, and it also encourages them to tailor their reports around the evidence that's already been collected instead of simply telling the truth. The citizens of Dallas, you and I, would never be afforded such luxury. We feel this policy and the unethical behavior of our police department can no longer be tolerated. And this policy will cost us many, many lives if unchallenged. Based on the crisis that we're facing in our communities right now as we speak with the police shootings, Mothers Against Police Brutality demand the following policies and procedures be instituted immediately. The policies include recommendations announced by Chief Brown himself over a year ago, and they were never implemented. Best practices from cities nationwide and recommendations that date back to the congressional hearings that were held in Dallas in 1987, and they were never implemented. Had they been implemented, many lives would have been saved. We want the chief to implement and enforce a real preservation of life policy. Grant meaningful subpoena power to the Dallas Police Citizen Review Board. Assign independent investigators to the Dallas Police Civilian Review Board to prepare cases concerning police misconduct and excessive force. Amend the deadly force policy from shoot to kill to shoot to disable. Implement training for officers on how to properly interact with minority persons, including but not limited to the use of force in annual and periodic training. Make statistics available of the race of the civilian involved, the officer involved. Make it available to the public. Agree to maintain the records of these implementations that we just mentioned, to maintain records for the next 10 years. Allocate state and federal resources to create a community-based independent task force to research best practices that come from critical incidents or institutions' failures in public safety from around the nation. Review and revoke the new shooting investigation policy, again, that allows officers that are involved in a shooting 72 hours to review before making a report. We want a fully developed and formalized foot check. fully reactivate the digital video recorder review team to build a public confidence that the department proactively examines officers' performance to ensure that compliance is with the department and with our public expectations. Implement a mandatory electronic control taser training policy for all officers. We want the Dallas District Attorney's Office to provide investigators on the ground when a crime occurs. We no longer want the Dallas District Attorney to wait for the Dallas Department to supply them with the reports before they decide to investigate. All major cities have. If you are a mother, or a parent, or a family member, and you want to get involved, this is your city, these are our children, you want to get involved with Mothers Against Police Brutality, please contact us at 214-989-8888 and Facebook us at Mothers Against Police Brutality. Don't wait until it happens to you. We have a lot of work to do, and we have to challenge these policies to save our children.
Good morning. I'm John Fullenmeyer, and I'm the president of the Dallas Peace Center. And I wanted to say that the Dallas Peace Center is fully committed to this movement. The encounter between police officers and the public, the encounter between a police officer and an unarmed suspect, more specifically, the encounter between a white police officer and a suspect who's African American or Latino, particularly a young man, this encounter seems to be frozen in time. Despite the undeniable progress that's been made in this country in the last 40 to 50 years, when a young black man faces off with a white police officer, the encounter is just as perilous as it was in 1973. Violence and homicide at the hands of the police is different than other forms of interpersonal violence. Police officer, of course, is a person. He may be angry that day. He might be irritated. He might be tired or hungry. He might feel vengeful, or he might just be scared. He's a person there, but he's also a representative of the power of the state. And in a democracy, that means that he's our representative. And when he shoots an unarmed suspect, when a police officer shoots an unarmed suspect, he's doing it in our name. And we can't allow this most insidious form of violence to continue. When a police officer changes serve and protect into harass, brutalize, and even murder, the social contract is broken, and it affects the whole society, not just the family who bears the most grievous blow. And we need to restore that social contract. Years ago, before some people in this room were born, I was part of bringing one of the first community crime prevention programs to Dallas. And at the time, it was very controversial involving the community and public safety. But now, community action, working with the police, et cetera, is considered conventional wisdom. And I am certain that the positions that Colette just outlined and the stance that we're taking will, in time, be the conventional wisdom for how a police department should conduct itself in relation to the community. That it remains controversial is part of the work that we have ahead. We can't launch a national movement on our own, but there are groups like this group in every city in America, and we will be connecting with them, and we will bring a national spotlight to Dallas until this issue is resolved.
Thank you. First of all, I'd just like to say this is an extremely historic moment for the mothers to be taking a stance against the police brutality. So I'd like to give a round of applause for that. You know, that's the old saying when we grow up that a parent should never bury their kid. But that's been going on for a long time. Now, last March, Clinton Allen was wrongfully killed, and we made a cry to this community. We said, we have an issue. We have a problem. Unarmed men are being killed by police officers. Had this city taken that cry serious, Bobby Bennett may have not been sitting in the hospital. Kellyanne Walker may not be in the hospital. Yes. There are individuals right now who have been shot. And had there not been video cameras, had there not been witnesses, these individuals could well be gone to jail. This is the type of issue that we have in Dallas. So we have to make our police officers accountable. We have to make our mayor stand behind the things that he says he's going to do. But most importantly, we have to make Chief Brown do what he's been hired to do. And that's to make sure that we have police officers that are serving and protecting the citizens. We should no longer have to have mothers wondering whether or not their kids are going to be harmed by police officers, the very individuals who are paid to protect. So we have to take a stance. I know the media said that we're going to be reaching out to the Department of Justice, and we're going to have to do this. We're going to have to get them to see what's happening in Miami, what happened in New Orleans, is now happening here in Dallas. We're going to have to make our police officers accountable. We're going to have to. I was looking at a police report. I was looking at the investigative report that I just received from the city. And let me tell you the ironic thing about it. They had Officer Staller. He was going through the investigation. Guess who he was with? He was with his attorney. They already had this situation already together. Staller and his attorney was going through the investigation with the city of Dallas. Why couldn't the district attorney's office, or why couldn't the family be a part of this investigation? We need to have transparency. The 72-hour policy, that's garbage. Because what this policy is doing is it's giving officers who have done something wrong, it's giving them the opportunity to get their stories together. And if you should not need 72 hours to tell somebody what happened. You either did it or you didn't. It's just that simple. So we have to have policies. In 1987, there was a report conducted here in Dallas, a very detailed report, and it stated at the time, we have issues in the city of Dallas. And they listed out a list of things that the city of Dallas and the Dallas Police Department needed to implement. They say, and one of the things, and this is very key, when you go through Officer Staller's, when you go through his background check, this is not a person that has a perfect background check. When you go down, they've shown him over and over inappropriate use of force. You go on this record, this is not something that I'm making up. Then this officer has misrepresentations, has falsified a police report on a couple of occasions. Now, in that recommendation in 1987, Colette, what it specifically said, if you have police officers that have a track record, that is a red flag that that police officer has emotional issues, and you need to put some type of steps into place to evaluate these police officers, Reverend Wright, so that we don't have police officers, like John said, going out on a very bad day because they're dealing with emotional issues and take it out on an unarmed individual. So we have to stand, Colette, we stand behind you, we stand behind the Mothers Against Police Brutality. This can't be something that just starts today and end. We have to make this a national movement because this is happening to mothers all over the United States, and it has to stop.
Good morning, I'm Reverend Ronald White, Executive Director of Justice Seekers of Texas, and I thank God for Mothers Against Police Brutality. Fortunate that it took 59 more shootings for us to stand up and be a voice. Silence helps the tormentor, not the tormented. We've been fighting this police brutality and shooting cases for over 15 years of innocent men being shot down. So 9 years ago, a young man got killed for stealing a candy bar at 7-Eleven, and there was nothing done. Silence helps the oppressor and not the oppressed. And so we thank God for this organization. Justice Seekers Texas is going to support them, but not just to monitor this police department, but we need the district attorney's office to stand up and be a voice and do what they are supposed to do, and that's investigate these cases and make sure the police department is doing their job as as well as the citizens that are doing their job. We cannot show disparity in police shootings. We are still waiting on 72 days we're going on for the response to David Blair's case, where police officers shot 12 times at an unarmed man and could have killed his little 3-year-old son. We have yet to get a response back from the Dallas Police Department. So these are the things that we are challenging and battling, and we thank God for all of you, but this entire city needs to be a voice. We don't need to wait till one of our loved ones gets shot down before we become a voice. It's not about us, it's about justice. And injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And so we thank you, we support you, and we must continue to fight until we get a victory out of this. Thank you.
At this time, if there are any questions from anyone from the press, we'll be willing to answer any questions. Not one.
Pardon?
Not one.
Yes, they have.
Not for shooting an unarmed man.
For
the only, yeah, just the one. That's right. The Bobby Bennett, Officer Cadence, I believe that's his name, Spencer Cadence. For officer shootings?
Yeah.
No, that's what we're talking about.
Well, we have yet to, as we've been fighting these battles, we have yet to see any get fired in police shooting and justice seekers that's been on board for, like I said, the last 10 years. And we have yet to see an officer get fired. We have yet to see one get indicted up until here recently. We haven't even got officers indicted.
And that's the most important thing that Reverend Wright said, just to address your question. It's not a matter of whether or not an officer has been fired. Because that's very simple. If you kill somebody and all the only consequences you're going to deal with is getting fired, what is that? I mean, what we want to do is we want these guys not only to be indicted, but we want them to be judged by a jury of their peers and have to stand to what they have done. I mean, I was happy when I looked at the city council. I know the city council met on this issue, and one of the city councilmen, Dwayne Carraway, acknowledged that we have a training issue. But one of the city councilmen announced that, well, we need to start fighting these cases and not just settling these cases. Well, there's an issue. You can't just fight a wrong. You have to stand up and you have to make these officers accountable, and we need to just stop sweeping things under the rug.
The reason I ask is that the police chief is African American. His attorney is African American. And it seems to be creating a problem.
And the sad part about that is this is not the first time that this has happened. And this is not the first time this has happened throughout history. We have, you know, if I want to do something wrong and I can get you to do something wrong with another person that I'm not going to do, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter about color right now. And color has absolutely nothing to do with you. Right. We have an African-American district attorney who has not indicted one police officer. I would like to thank and hope that these officers are not trying to make Chief Brown look bad, because if they are, they're doing a good job. And if the justice system is trying to make Craig Watkins look bad, then they are doing a good job. Because he's making both of them look bad, because they're not doing what they said they were going to do. When Dave Brown took this job, he said, Reverend Wright, don't show no mercy on me. And trust me, I have not shown any mercy on him. He's going to do just like he was. If he was David Kopp or anybody else, he's going to get it from us.
Are you going to be talking directly to Chief Brown?
Well, Chief Brown has a certain selection of people he want to speak with. Here recently, and right now,
well,
this particular group, go ahead, because I know he's not trying to get justice.
We're going to reach out to Chief Brown, and we want to work with him. We want these policies and procedures in place. As far as color, having a black district attorney and having a black police chief, it's not about color, it's about the character and the ability to lead. You could be black, purple, or brown. If you're in a capacity in a job and you are not capable of doing that job, then we need to get someone else to do it. So we can't feel safe. Our community is not just simply safe because it's black men that are being killed and Hispanic men are being killed because we have a black police chief and a black district attorney. So we want them to do their job. If they were Hispanic or if they were white or polka dot, we want them to do their job. And we want all children to be safe. We want all mothers' children, all mothers' sons to be able to go to the store or to ride in the car with three other black boys and come home safe.
So I think one of the things that we truly need to look at in Dallas is that we have an issue with the grand jury system. It's not just the district attorney. It's a grand jury that's not that are nobling these individuals. So if we want to focus on something, we want to focus on the grand jury situation that Jamie Bagnall has been primarily the person at the district attorney's office that's been over this situation. And Jamie Bagnall and a lot of these guys, in fact, the person that represents Officer Stahl is a former district attorney. So if you look at it, we have a situation where a lot of these people are connected, and there's a reason why not one, well, only two police officers have been indicted in the last 40 years. That's a problem.
And even though they hold those positions, that don't mean they run those organizations, and we know that. This is the 21st century. Come on. Even though you're the chief, don't mean you don't have the last say as to what go on. What is unfortunate is that the chief found it not robbery to apologize to one family and wouldn't apologize to another. So there can never be a disparity in injustice. He felt it was all right to apologize to the young man that got shot by an officer, but what about these mothers that are out here right now? What about David Blair, who you shot at but you didn't kill? When are you going to apologize to him? So even though you're the chief, don't mean you're the head.
And Reverend Wright, the problem also that we had when Bobby Bennett got shot, we had a mayor of Dallas and a chief of police who could not come out immediately and issue a statement after we had a video showing exactly what happened. I mean, it took over 3 to 4 days before we even got an official statement from the policymakers. So these are issues, these are things that need to be corrected right away.
Have you had conversations with other mothers who have found themselves in your situation? If so, what are those meetings and those moments like to be characterized, what it's like to talk to somebody who's going through what you've been?
It's heartbreaking. I've spoken with mothers that are, they can't fight because they've been stonewalled. They've never even gotten information about their son's case. The police department won't talk to them. Any reports that they get are redacted. It tears a family apart. The financial burden. These mothers can't even tap into the victim's fund because it's under investigation, or because the city says that their son did this, or, you know. So in the financial burden, you know, when this person is taken out of the household, like my son, Clinton Allen, was the breadwinner for his twin sons. And so there's a rippling effect that happens. So I've spoken with lots of mothers in Atlanta and New Orleans and Los Angeles and in Dallas. We are uniting to become one force and to fight. As I say, you know, if we have to go all the way to the Supreme Court on that 72-hour rule, we're coming together as one force and moving from next city to the next city, whatever that city's issue is. But we're going to start here in Dallas first.
Touch on your question just a little bit as well, because I actually talked to a mother on the way to this press conference this morning. What typically happens is a lot of these young men who are killed, they come from families that don't have the resources. They come from families that don't have the knowledge of how to pursue these type of issues. And it's really heartbreaking, because there was just an article just recently, whenever you have these type of situations, what ends up happening is the victim gets put on trial. The officers are ignored, and they focus on the background of the victim. So what happens is you have a mentality now in the community where they are scared to come forward, because they know if they come forward, they're going to be put on trial and not the actual officer that actually killed the individual. So that's a huge issue that's going on.
Here's another issue, too, is that a lot of the citizens don't know that a lot of these cases are settled out of civil court, and it's taxpayers' money that's paying for wrongful shootings by Dallas police officers that doesn't make the newspaper, doesn't make the press. But they, right now, Tobias Mackey, who was gunned down by a Dallas police officer, case is in trial now, and they're trying to settle that case. That's taxpayers' money. And if the city has to pay for these wrongful shootings, then why can't we indict these officers?
One more point that I want to make before we wrap up, unless anyone else has any questions. The other thing that we have to know, be reminded of, and a lot of you may not know, is that when you have a district attorney's office that works in symphony with the police department it's not good business. In our case, the grand jury, we had witnesses that were not allowed to testify. We have to make sure that every case is given due diligence. Every case. Every black man, Hispanic, white man, Asian man, every citizen should be given due diligence. And that's what we want to make sure happens. We want to make sure that best practices are put forward and that policies and procedures are changed so that families can have